So, hi guys, I am Indrani Roy and I am now a second year graduate student at UIC, University of Illinois at Chicago. And obviously, I was a student of ISER Vishwabharati. And so, I'm really grateful for the opportunity that you guys have given me to present in front of all of you. So, yeah, thank you very much. And so, here is my topic. I'm going to talk about X-ray absorption spectroscopy today. This is a spectroscopy technique, and I am also going to share that how we can use this technique for determining the chemical and electronic states. So, before starting, I would like to have this laser pointer, and also let me see. Yeah, here it is, the first one. What is X-ray absorption spectroscopy? So as we are like mostly we use UV visible spectroscopy and infrared IR that we have generally read, right? So if you look here, so infrared or UV visible spectroscopy or visible spectroscopy, this has an energy range. This all technique have an energy range of 1 to 100 kilocalorie per mole. But in this technique, X-ray absorption technique, we are going to use X-rays. And these X-rays generally have 10 to the power 4 kilocalorie per mole. So that you can see the energy is very high. And because X-rays have a huge amount of energy, what they does is they ionize. They ionize the electron. And what do I mean by ionization? So here is my nucleus. And if you look here, these are the shells, K, L, M edges, right? And so K is generally S electrons, and then, K edge is generally S electrons, then L edge, we have p orbitals, and then M edge, we have again the higher orbitals, right? So what happens when we shine X-ray on this? Electrons are is when you shine X-ray, it will actually eject this electron to this continuum. That is, like it will eject this electron outer to your whole atom. So this is what we call as photoelectron. So you can see that this is knocking out the whole electron from the system. This is called ionization. So this we can study via XPS, X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy. But when we talk about X-ray absorption spectroscopy, we actually study this electron. If this electron is not knocked out from the system, whereas it can go to some higher orbital, right? You know that L edge can have a maximum of 8 electrons. And if you count here, you have actually 7 electrons. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and 7. So if you have 7 electrons, you can understand that there is one electron still there that can be accommodated in this L edge, right? So when you have this L edge, when you have one electron less in L edge, so my S electron can go here and sit, right? So it can occupy this state. So when it occupies the state, that time the energy it releases that can be recorded, and that is what we study in X-ray absorption spectroscopy. I know this seems a little too much chemistry, but before we proceed to this talk, I actually want to let you guys know what is X-ray absorption. That's why I'm talking so much about it. So just nothing. It's very simple. We are shining X-ray. Either the electron can be knocked out of the whole system or it can go to any of the higher atomic orbital, right? And then whatever phenomena, whatever energy change is happening, that we can record. And that is what is X-ray absorption spectroscopy in a very simple term. Now let's see how we can actually generate X-ray. So much of you can see that different element to knock out, we all know about the Wark function and everything, right? So to knock out an electron, you have to actually cross the barrier. and then you have to make give the electron sufficient amount of energy that it can actually knocked out of the, it can go beyond the warp function and it can be ejected. So from where we are getting so much amount of energy. So here comes the synchrotron. That is, I think that is going to be the most interesting part, because in India, we have only one synchrotron that is not yet fully developed. So that's why we generally don't talk much about X-ray absorption spectroscopy in India very much. So in our colleges or schools, you have learned about a lot of spectroscopy technique, but I'm sure you haven't really read in depth about the X-rays, because in India, there is not much X-ray studies going on. And the sole reason for that is not a very well-developed synchrotron system. So what is synchrotron and why is it so important to have a good synchrotron system? So synchrotron is a huge area. If you think about a synchrotron, it can be the whole Vishwabharati University campus. So if you see here, it's a round system and there is a different parts here. So this part, the first is where you actually create X-ray. So this is the X-ray source. This is called the electron gun. So from here, you can produce the X-ray. And second is the linear, from where you can actually, after producing the X-ray, you can channel this X-ray through this LINAC system. And here is your electromagnetic field. This is the first round shaped ring. This is called, this third portion you see, this is called the booster ring. So in this booster ring, there is electromagnetic field. And what does this booster ring do is, it actually, the electron gun has produced some amount of X-ray and this, some amount of electrons. And now the LINAC has focused those electrons into the booster ring. And via the electromagnetic field in the booster ring, this booster ring is going to accelerate those electrons at the speed of light, almost at the speed of light, right? Very close to the speed of light. And then it's going to be accelerated at that speed. And after that, through this channel, it's going to come to the storage ring. Why it is called storage ring? Because once the accelerated electron beams come here, it will at least stay for 24 hours or more. How much time actually we want the facility to run? It will run here. This is called the storage ring. And in this storage ring, we have bending magnets. So these are two magnets. These are called bending magnets because they can actually bend the beam of electrons to the desired position. See here, there are all these stations. These are called the beam lines. Number six, these are the end stations or beam lines. So here we have this, in the storage ring, we have the bending magnet, and this magnet will actually direct the beam to the desired position. And in that end station, you can have different techniques, like one of the techniques is X-rays, XAS, XPS, XRD. So wherever you need a huge amount of X-ray energy, you can actually look into these beam lines and you can go there and you can get the desired amount of X-ray you want to get, right? So this is how a synchrotron work. I have a video for that. That's what I want to share with you all guys. So you will get to understand what synchrotron actually, how the synchrotron operates. So let me share this video with you. See, this is the beam, and then this is this ring happening. sorry. So that was the video, I guess. I hope you guys have understood something about the synchrotron. If you guys have any question, I can take right now about synchrotron. If you have any question on the synchrotron, I can have right now, and then we can go more details on the XAS. If anybody has any question on synchrotron.
I have one. What is the most main difference between a particle accelerator and a synchrotron?
I think in particle accelerator, I'm not sure how will I answer this question. I'm not very sure about the particle accelerators. I guess in particle accelerator, you can produce, other than electron, you can produce a lot of mesons and photons, I guess. That may be the main difference. In synchrotron, we mostly produce only electrons. We concentrate only electrons, and then from electrons you get to you're getting the light source basically. I'm not sure what particle accelerator does.
Okay.
Sorry.
Indrani?
Yes, ma'am.
Indrani?
Yes, ma'am.
Which synchrotron facility you are using in your university?
I'm using APS, argon particle accelerator.
No, where is this synchrotron? Means where is it located? Not in your university, maybe, right? You have to use some other facility from other institute, like Electra or DESI or something like that. So which one you are using?
We are using APS. It's very close to UIC, and UIC is one of the partners. Argon.
Okay.
It's very close. It's like 10 miles, within 10 miles.
Means you can go and do the measurements yourself. Means you have gone there, right?
Yes, ma'am. Okay.
There is a question in chat box by Priyodarshi Stapavan Sahu. He is asking that at the end, where is the high energy particle getting absorbed at? And it must have an end, right?
Accelerated the synchrotron? Okay.
I'll ask Stapavan to say his question.
It's actually...
I think he is here.
It's actually not when you stop the accelerator, it will stop producing the electron. So it's not getting absorbed. So when you start the synchrotron, let me share you the basic one here. So when you start the synchrotron first, you're starting the electron beams here, and then you're actually doing all the acceleration. And in the storage ring, if you see, here are the bending magnets, right? So this bending magnets actually bending your beam and directing it to the different end stations. So in the end station, you can stop. It will absorb it. It's having like, it's not really stopping unless you stop the beam. It's not getting absorbed. It's not having, it's not actually getting absorbed anywhere. Either you will stop or the facilities will actually use that. Am I clear?
Anything more?
Hello.
So you're
he says okay.
Yeah, okay. You're stopping it. It's not really getting absorbed. It's depleted. So you are using those beam for your experiment. So your material is absorbing, or the environment is absorbing. So it's getting depleted. So not really. There is no end right now, unless you stop the whole generation of the electron itself. Yeah. Okay. Any more questions, guys? Yes. Yes, Abhinav. I can't hear you, Abhinav. Can you be a little louder?
Hello.
Yeah. Thank you.
We produce X-ray like by bombarding the electrons with some metal surface, then we will get K-shell knockout and then X-ray.
I can't hear you.
In first slide, you shared that high energy electrons will knock out the electrons, then X-rays will be produced.
Yes. No, actually, I'm shining X-ray. And I'm knocking out the electron. I'm shining. This incident photon is my X-ray. I'm shining X-ray, and that is that energy of X-ray is actually knocking out my electron, or it's actually it's letting the electron go to in a higher orbital. Yeah.
But for producing X-ray also we have to bombard high energy.
Hello.
I can hear.
But for producing the X-ray, we have to bombard a high moving electrons into some metal surface. Then only X-rays will be produced, no?
Yes.
In
so,
synchrotron. In synchrotron, we are doing that, accelerating the electron, and then at the end there will be some metal, some specific metal that will produce X-ray.
Yes.
But that will produce X-ray of some specific wavelength, and for spectroscopy we have to use like range of wavelengths to detect absorption or how will produce that range?
So this electron in synchrotron, actually it's not only one particular kind of metal. It's a huge system, and it actually uses those cathode ray experiment, you remember those kind of things they use. They produce electrons of different wavelengths. It's not only a single type of wavelength. Single type of wavelengths are here at the end station, where you have a monochromator and you are getting the particular one kind of X-ray or one kind of energy you are going to, you are liking. So from the electron beam, electron gun that is being used in this synchrotron, they can have a range of wavelengths. It's not a particular kind of wavelength they use. It's a huge system.
Oh.
So it can have a different zones of different levels of wavelengths and whatever energy you want. It's a huge amount of energy they give.
Okay.
Yeah,
in response of the first question, Tapoban is saying again that so that the end station we get the result and then we stop the acceleration.
No, actually we do not stop the acceleration. These accelerators are like go on forever and ever. So we can stop this, actually do not get stopped unless it is going through a major, even if it's going to major upgrades and stuff. So we do not stop this electron gun. We do not stop. Once the electron gun is started, we do not stop the electron gun. We can stop our end stations facilities. Like, so this bending magnets, you can stop one of the bending magnets so it won't bend the X-ray beam to the particular station. It won't be stopped ever unless major disruption happens, like some catastrophic event happens. It won't be stopped. If you stop once, it will take maybe some 6 months to start again. So we generally do not stop the synchrotron facilities.
Yeah, he replied that he understood.
Okay, great. I know it's a lot to digest, because I can tell you that it's the whole university. If you think about the whole university radius, it's that big to have a synchrotron over there. And it's almost, when you see the storage ring, it's almost when the electrons start like moving in those ring, it will be almost equivalent to our solar system radius. It's like when it goes moves on and on. So it's a huge system, a huge facility. You cannot stop the electrons coming and going out, you know. So you can only stop the stations. Okay, thanks Tapoban for your interest and asking questions. That was good questions actually. Okay, any more questions, guys? Okay, let me proceed further then. So let's talk about the X-rays now. In synchrotron, not only X-rays, you can do a lot of different types of experiments based on X-rays, XRD, XPS, Zanes, and then all different kind of X-ray based experiments. So now let's go into more detail of XAS. What is the basic principle and how it works basically? So as I told you, you have K edge, L edge, M edge, right? So once actually you shine your X-ray, either you are again the same thing, either your electron can go to continuum, or this is the continuum where this is the last of the whole system, or it can go to intermediate states, right? 1s2, it can go to 4d, it can go to 4p. Generally, we do not consider it going to 2p or 2s. If we are talking about the 3d metals, right? We do not consider it going to 2p or 2s because it's a very small transition and we will not get sufficient information from this transition. We think about bigger leaps from 1s to 4p, 1s to 3d, right? And again, that is if the transition is happening from 1s to 4p or 1s to 3d, then we call it as k edge because this transition is happening from 1s or s orbital, not 1s, from s orbital. Anything from s orbital, we consider it as k edge. L edge is if our transition is happening from 2s or 2p, the 2 is there, right? This 2s or 2p, that is the L edge. From L edge, if we are making the transition from 2s, 2p to 3d, then we call it as L edge. From k to 4s, 4p, 4d, that is kh. And from 2s to 2s or 2p to 3d, we call it as lh. And you can understand that there is an energy difference between kh and lh. So if you need an electron to come out from the 1s, that is the most innermost shell, right? That is closest to the nucleus. So the Z effective is going to be very high. And the work function that the 1s electron has is also going to be a lot. That's why to overcome that work function, you need to provide a huge amount of energy. You can see the difference here. If you're thinking about the ferrous, you know, it's a d electron system, right? So you want to take one electron from its 1s orbital, and you want to make it go to 4p or 3d level, right? So the amount of energy you need is 7,000 electron volt. But this is for the same ferrous atom, if you want one electron from the LH, either from 2s or 2p, now you see your 2s or 2p orbital is far from the nucleus. So the Z effective is much less than the 1s. So the energy requirement is almost 10 times less. It's 720 electron volt. So that's why we also divide the X-ray into two regions, hard X-rays and soft X-rays, we call it. Hard means more energy, more amount of X-ray energy you require, and soft means you need less amount of energy, less amount of X-ray energy. So that's we call as hard and soft. And for you think about oxygen, it's a p orbital, like the it's a p block element, right? So for oxygen, you need to, if you also want to knock out one electron from 1s, you need to give it much less amount of energy than ferrous, because ferrous is a d metal, d orbital element, and oxygen is a p orbital element, right? So you can understand the difference based on the Z effective, right? Any doubts on that? How we are talking about this hard and soft XAS? Hard and why we need more energy for kh of metals versus kh of ligands. Any doubts on that? Anybody, any doubts? Why we need less, more or less energies? Okay. I think you guys understood that basic difference based on this 1s and p electron. So basically whatever we do in XS, we want this one electron in the innermost orbital goes into a higher orbital. That's it. And then we vary our energy and we get some data based on their transition. Now let's see how the spectrum looks. So once you perform an experiment, an XAS experiment, your spectrum will look something like that. Here I have overlapped two spectrum. I did not. The Stanford SSRL facility has done this experiments and I have taken the slides from their results. So they have overlapped actually two spectrum. Here you can see two spectrum. And this is how generally a metal XAS experiment will look like. So you have a pre-H over here. This is called, okay, let's talk about first Zens and XFs first. So this region, you can divide this whole spectrum into two regions. One is Zens, that is X-ray near edge absorption spectroscopy. And this is X-ray, extended X-ray absorption fine structure, right? And today we are going to basically focus on Zens. And then Zanes, this spectroscopy, this whole spectroscopy also, this is so huge, so much of energy. We cannot really, most of the scientists cannot really focus on both the arenas, Zanes and XFs. So what I do in my research, I only focus on Zanes, the near edge spectrum. And I try to gain some informations about electronic and geometric information, right? Like oxidation state, what is the covalency, how the electronic transitions happen, this kind of information. And this extended fine structure spectroscopy will give you a lot of geometric information, even from the continuum. When the electron goes to the last continuum level, they can give you a lot of information of that also. So XFs is a very mathematical based technique. It needs a lot of fitting, and I don't know much about XFs. I only do Zanes, and let's talk about Zanes in more details, okay? So just remember, from Zanes, we can get a lot of information of electronic and geometric information, like oxidation states, like covalency, and stuff like that, right? So let's go into more detail. So now—
the both spectrum are of same material.
Yes, that is, this is the,
last.
Yes, both the spectrum, no, this is, no, both the spectrum are not from the same material. This is copper and this is ferrous, I guess. Yeah, this is just overlap. This is just to give you a flavor that how different materials will look. That's all. I'll explain this. They do not look very different right now, but once I finish the lecture, you will understand that they are really very different.
Okay. There is a question in chat box by Sudam. He is asking that core hole effect in XAS depend on what physical factors, and he is asking again that what are the methods to check if an X-ray spectrum is correct.
Okay, what methods, whether the X-ray spectrum is correct or not? Okay, I'll answer all your questions. Maybe a little bit later, while we go to the like more details into the spectrum, I'll answer your questions. If it hasn't been answered, please remind once again. I'll try to go through the questions.
And his first question was that core hole effect in XAS depends on what physical factors?
Core hole effect. I don't really understand what is core hole effect in XAS. Core hole effect.
Sudam, can you?
Yeah, Sudam.
Can you unmute yourself and just say it?
Yeah.
What you want to say? Sudam, are you here?
Sudam wrote that he is facing mic problem.
Oh, okay. Core hole effect. I can see the chat box now. I actually don't understand what do you mean by core hole effect. I can say that core, this is the core electron, and I'm like taking it to a hole kind of stuff, because I don't have electrons in my higher orbitals. So it depends on what physical factors. Maybe like what I understand maybe, that is manganese 2. If I'm talking about manganese 2 and manganese 3 over here, so both are manganese. I'm talking about the LH and KH. And let's say if I have manganese 2 and manganese 3, it has two different oxidation states. That means it has different d electrons. So this core hole effect will solely depend on your unoccupied orbitals. That's what I can feel, I guess. I'm not sure if I'm understanding your question correctly or not. Okay. I will come to the to your next last question later. How will you understand whether it's correct or not? Okay. Let me go to the next maybe. Is there any more question?
No.
Okay.
You can proceed.
Okay. Okay, guys, let me proceed a little bit more. So as I told you, I only focus on Zanes. The whole spectra you saw, I divided into two parts. First is Zanes and the next part was XFs. So the Zanes also, again, Zanes also we can classify into different regions. First is mainly two regions. One is pre-edge and one is edge. So how pre-edge is generated? Pre-edge is generally arise because of 1s is going to any of the D levels. 1s is going to 3D levels. That is actually giving rise to this pre-edge. And 1s can also go to the 4p level, right? That is the higher orbital again, one more higher orbital. So 1s, if 1s goes to p orbital, that's going to give rise to the edge position. So that is what, and after that, it goes to after 4p, it's continuum. That means there is no electron levels. It goes to the outermost, even it crosses the outermost orbital and it goes to the continuum. So that can be studied using XFs, but in Zanes, we consider only 1s to 3d, that gives rise to pre-edge, and 1s to 4p, or if you are talking about the 5d metals, then 5d and 6p's electrons. So that is going to give rise to edge positions. So if you see, the pre-edge is much lesser in intensity and edge is much higher in intensity. Why this happens? Because both of these transitions are possible. But why we have less intensity in pre-edge and why we have more intensity in edge position? That depends on the allowed transitions and forbidden transitions. If you guys have not learned yet about the allowed transitions and forbidden transition, let me tell you guys a little bit about it. So dipole are allowed transition. That means you have del L is equals 1. Del L means I am talking about S to P. That the L level difference is only 1, right? That is called dipole allowed transitions. So if you see 1s to 4p, that is dipole allowed transition. And dipole allowed transitions are mostly the most prominent transition you can see. That gives rise to a huge, a nice spectrum, a nice intensity of spectrum. So if you look at the transition from 1s to 4p, that is going to give rise to edge position. And that's why the edge is very sharp and it's very prominent. But pre-edge is also important because the transition is possible and it is quadruple allowed, but dipole forbidden, right? Dipole forbidden because we are going from 1s to 3d orbitals, 1s to d, s to d orbitals, right? The transition is happening from s to d. There is a difference of 2. L is equals plus minus 2. That's why it's a weak transition. Because it is not dipole allowed, it is dipole forbidden. That's why it's a weak transition, right? Am I making sense to you guys? This is a rule that dictates what transitions are allowed and what transitions are forbidden. That is the you will learn about it while ma'am will teach you about this allowed transitions and forbidden transition. You will learn more about it. Just a reminder, I guess. So that's why this pre-edge is a little less and these edge positions are very strong and very prominent, but we cannot really omit the pre-edge because it's going to give you a lot of information. Let's see how we can use this excess in our real studies. So here I have copper 2 and copper 3. Any questions on the previous slide? I'll take questions if you guys have any on this. Any questions on this? Okay, let me go ahead then. So, oxidation state. As I told you, Zanes will give you a lot of information of the oxidation state. So I have here two metals, copper 2 and copper 3. Copper 2 and copper 3 is copper 2 plus and copper 3 plus. So you think what is the number of d electrons here. So you can see that copper 2 copper is D9, copper 2 system is D9 system, and copper 3 is D8 system, right? There is a difference in D electrons. So you just keep it in mind, and from here we can actually calculate the oxidation state. We can see the spectrum and can say what is the oxidation state. How? The rising edge and the edge maxima shift to a higher energy as the oxidation state increases. That is the main point here. Why? As you saw in the previous slide, it's all about the transitions, remember? So we are only talking about the transition. So 1s to 3d. So now in one of my system, copper 2, I have D9 electrons, and one in the other, I have D8 electrons, right? So based on that, I have available states. I have in D9, I have only one D orbital available for transition, and in D8, I have two available systems, right? Two available states for the transition. So that's why in one case, I will have a shift in the spectrum. It will shift to the higher energy for more number of oxidation state, because now I have more states available for the electron to occupy. I'm shining my X-ray, I'm knocking out my 1s electron and making it go to D orbital, right? So in copper 2, I can only make one 1s electron go to D orbital, and in copper 3, I can make two 1s electron or two 2p electron go to D orbital. So that's why there is a shift in the oxidation state. There is a shift in this energy. So whenever we plot this X-rays graph, we plot in terms of energy versus absorption. So more energy will be absorbed in case of copper 3 than copper 2. So from this spectrum, directly seeing the spectrum, if you see a shift in the spectrum that is going to higher energy, you can say, okay, this species have a higher energy. Now, but important consideration, we are talking about similar ligand. We are talking about copper 2 oxide or copper 3 oxide, copper 2 fluoride, copper 3 fluoride, not copper 2 oxide and copper 2 fluoride, because ligands, different ligands will also interact with your metal in different ways and can create a lot of anomalies in your spectrum. So this is just a side note. We are only talking about similar ligand system. And then we are comparing the oxidation state. And the next is, again, some more details into oxidation state. As you can see, ferrous 2 and ferrous 2. Now in this case, both are ferrous system. And you see the red one has shifted to higher energy. So now what we are getting from this higher energy, we are getting the information about the spin state. So spin states are different. One ferrous system, the red one, is in low spin system, and the black spectrum, if you see, that is in high spin system. You know about the high spin and low spin, right? I am assuming that you know the high spin and low spin metal system, and I am proceeding from that. Those who don't know, just don't worry, you will learn eventually. And in case of nickel 2 and nickel 3, again, if the spin is high, you will see less, the low spin will have more energy absorption than the high spin ones. So we can see that the oxidation state and the spin state, we can get the information about oxidation state and the spin state from this metal KH spectra. Zins. So again, now let's see if we can get the coordination number and some geometrical information from our spectrum. So now I have taken all copper 1 system, and now I'm comparing their coordination numbers. So the first black one is my 2 coordinated. Here you can see the 2 coordinated copper system. Now the green one is my 3 coordinated copper system, and the fourth one is my 4 coordinated copper system. So black, green, and red. I have all the oxidation states are all similar, but the coordination states are different. Now, because of this coordination states are different, we have different 1:4p transition emission energy, we are all talking about absorption. So this is absorption energy. So because the coordination states are different, the amount of energy that will be absorbed is different, and that's why we will see the change of the spectrum itself. It's not only shifting to higher energy or shifting to lower energy. The whole shape of the spectrum is very different because now I have anomaly in the coordination system itself. So once you know this difference that I have different, once you see the spectrum, you can see that, okay, either they don't have the same metal, or if they have the same metal, they don't have the same coordination system, right? So from this, the shape of this cage, metal cage, can also give you coordination system. Yes, any question?
One thing, why in case of like the spectrum, in case of the three coordination copper system, this is like the very smooth, and but in case of that two coordination, is there any reason?
There is definitely reason. All the edges you are seeing is one of the 1:1 transition, right? So if you see here, there's a sharp, you can see there's only one peak, and that's a sharp peak. And if you see carefully, there is another jump here, and there is another jump here. And in three coordination, you can see as pre-edge, and then you have two transitions over here. So there is definitely, whenever you see a spectrum and you see see some roughness, it's not rough, it's all peaks, or every peak represents 1:1 transition. So if you see here in two coordination, you can have the jump over here 1 and 2. You can have the jumps here 1, 2, and 3. So you see 1 jump, 2, and 3 jumps. In one coordination system, it's mostly one jump, because now it also depends on the number of electron states available. It's all copper one system. So it's all D10, I guess. It's all D10.
In case of the four coordination system in the red color, there is that 1, 2 jumps, but there is, I can see that PXYZ, the everything are degenerates are showing that PXYZ are same. So why this? Different type of jump.
There should be one only, but then it's all D10, so there is no Jung-Taylor distortion also. So there is basically one jump, and this jump I'm not sure why. Yeah.
Okay.
I have to look into it. It should be, because it's all degenerate, there should be only one jump, and it's also D10 system, so no Jung-Taylor distortion. There should be one jump. I'm not sure why am I seeing this. Maybe it's coming from the continuum. Maybe this is the part.
Is it altered? That means what is showing in the three coordinations, and then that must be four, and the four will be three. Is it color is get changed somewhere?
I'm not sure. It should not be. I'm not sure.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. It's okay. Sorry. Okay. Also, one thing that Sudham is replied about what he mean by the core hole effect. He said that core hole means I am talking about Coulomb interaction between a hole in an inner shell and an excited electron.
Coulomb interaction. Actually, I'm not sure if we are talking really about Coulomb interaction. Coulomb interaction is taken into consideration about the work function. So Coulomb interaction is a part of work function that we are covering, giving a sufficient amount of energy. So I think Coulomb interaction is taken care by the work function itself. And then after overcoming the work function, we are talking about moving one electron from the 1s orbital to the higher energy or to the continuum. So I'm not sure, Sudham, that the Coulomb interaction has anything to do with the XAS spectrum itself. XAS is the after we are overcoming the Coulomb interaction and all the work function. After that, now we are talking about 1s jumps to higher orbital. So that transition we are talking about. We are not really concerned about overcoming the work function. That is being taken care of different amount of energy that we are providing to the system itself. I think that's correct. Yeah.
Yeah, he replied okay.
Yeah, I think he is clear now. Yeah. Okay, guys, do you have any more questions on that? I'm sorry, Shobuj, I couldn't reply to your question very properly. I will look into it and I'll get back to you. I think that's really, I'm not sure how it's happening. Yeah. Anybody, any more doubts here? Okay, let's see a little more. That is covalency, and that's going to be, I guess, that's all we can do about doing this whole XAS absorption. So intensity is directly proportional to covalency, because covalency, 1 by covalency is inversely proportional to energy. So what happens, intensity, if you have an intense peak, that means you have more covalency in the system. But if you see that your system is moving to a higher energy, that means you have less covalency, because covalency is inversely proportional to energy, but it is directly proportional to the intensity, right? So you see here, this system has more intensity and it has shifted to lower energy. So it is more covalent than the black one. So again, pre-edge intensity, this is a very important thing. So pre-edge, why we are really concerned about pre-edge? Because pre-edge can give you a lot of information. Because in pre-edge, we are considering the transition from 1s to 4p, 1s to p, sorry, d orbitals, right? And we know that the transition metal are so great because of their d orbital chemistry. So pre-edge is basically, in pre-edge, we are basically considering on that aspect. So here you see, I have an octahedral system and I have a tetrahedral system. So in tetrahedral system, if you look at the tetrahedral system, you see that I have a mixing of 4p and 3d orbital. And we know that pre-edge are really less intensity because they are quadrupole allowed and dipole forbidden. That means if I have to have a more intense pre-edge, I need a really good mixing of 3D and 4P, because now I have more amount of 4P character in my orbital. So that's why, because the tetrahedral get an intense mixing, we get an intense pH peak. But in case of octahedral, this overlapping is not great. The 4P and 3D orbital overlapping is not great. That is all coming into the symmetry. I'm sure when you learn more about the group theory, you will learn about the symmetries. And from there, we can say that symmetry is very important. Like T2 symmetry and T2 symmetry over here, you can see. So that's why they will have a greater overlapping, greater mixing. And that's why we will have an intense pH peak. But in case of octahedral, we can see T1U, Ungirade and Girade symmetry over here. That's why we will not have a good overlapping, and that's why there will be no mixing. And that's why the pre-edge, sometimes this pre-edge will be even absent. We can't even determine if there is a pre-edge or not. It's all based on this symmetry and also our geometry, tetrahedral and octahedral geometry, right? So we can also comment on the geometry from this K-edge spectrum. So any question on this, how this overlapping mixing is happening, why this is creating an intense pH peak or weak peak? Is it any question on that? So you can see, guys, it's a really very thorough process of understanding the metal chemistry or the understanding the electronic and geometrical shapes of any metal. Not only metal, we can do for ligands also. That just takes less energy, and trust me, guys, ligands are much more complicated because we are only talking about the 1s to p transition, and then the overlapping and mixing will be there with the metals. So that makes the chemistry a little bit complicated. But this, for metals, that is straightforward, and you can get a lot of information from this XAS spectrum for this metal. Now, let's discuss why we are really interested. Why am I really interested for knowing so much details about this? Okay, there is another one, ligand field. So again, ligand field is also very much similar to what I described. Pre-edge intensity weighted average is modulated by ligand field strength. Z effective is the Z effective changes. Obviously, the energy absorption will be changed and you will see a difference in the spectrum. So as I was talking about, why am I interested? Because this is the recent paper that our group has published. So in our group, what we do is we are mostly concerned about the battery materials. We work in lithium ion batteries. So here you can see Haifeng has published this paper and he has worked on lithium ruthenium oxide. So first we synthesize the material and then we cycle the material like your mobile has. Your mobile is also having a lithium ion battery. So you charge and discharge it, right? So once you charge, you plug in your mobile and your battery is now fully charged state. And now you do all the work. You use your mobile and the charge gets depleted. And again you charge. And again it gets depleted. And again you charge. So this charging and discharging cycle we perform in the lab in coin cells. And then we see how the material behaves. So at each step, we collect the material and do some XRD and do some XS studies. And we see why. So this is a common phenomena that after some time, your battery start behaving oddly, do not get charged properly. And there is a lot of problem you face, right? If you really use your battery for a long time, if you use the mobile for a long time. So what happens? Charge depletions take place. The material that gives that perform this charge and discharge cycle is not behaves properly because the material itself get depleted in a crude way. So we try to see how we can improve this charging cycle and what low cost material we can incorporate like ruthenium, manganese. I work on manganese. So these are really low cost material. Right now what we are using is nickel batteries that are really costly. So in our group, we try to see what are the options we have for battery materials and why the charging and discharging takes place and why this things happen. So we collect each phase. So this is a charging discharging cycle. And then at each point, we collect, this is only for first time. We collect the material and takes the excess for all of them. And after that, I see why we are seeing the depletion. So you can see there is an oxidation as I just described you guys. It's over peak. You can see the spectrum has moved to a side, to higher energies side. And that means I can say that the oxidation state has changed. So that's why it is important for us to understand what is happening in the process, because oxidation state is important because we do redox chemistry. So that's why we want to see why it is happening. And XRD is important because we see what happens when we actually, after a long time of cycling, what changes has happened to the material. So that is thank you guys for your question. I'll take any questions you have. So guys, do you have any questions?
Yeah. The things you told in case of this, the lithium ion battery. So actually, what do you want to change? My question is, what do you want to change in that?
Yeah.
Lithium ion battery, but what is the replacement or this? Anything is the, in case of the matrix or something.
So basically, yeah, that's a good question. I should have pointed out. So I actually work on cathode material. So any battery has cathode and anodes. So anode right now, we are in a good shape that we can say that my anode material is going to be graphite or silicon. So much exploration has been happened to anode. Now we are really concerned about the cathode materials. And these cathode materials, we have lithium in our cathode system. So lithium is constant, but now we have different metal oxides and I work in oxyfluorides, oxides plus fluorides. And I want to see, so right now we use lithium nickel NMC, that is nickel, manganese and cobalt battery, that is very costly. So I want to see that if I can use, instead of NMC, I can only use manganese, because that is a low cost material. So I'm changing this metal itself. Instead of ruthenium, I only use manganese. And again, I vary the ratio of lithium to manganese. I vary the oxide, not only oxide, I use fluoride, because you know, guys, fluorine is very ionic. It's highly ionic system. It's having a huge electronegativity. So that's why I also want to replace oxygen with fluorine. And not only fluorine, I also want to use oxyfluoride. So we are changing the cathode material itself also for the energy density, so that it have more energy density and sometime it can perform better. Energy density means it can perform better cycling capacity. It can perform for you. Suppose right now in mobile, you can charge it for 2 years. I want to increase it till 5 years. So that means I am trying to increase the energy density of my battery material. I also want the cost to be down. So basically what I change is the ligand and the metals, and also the lithium ratio. Yeah.
I get it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any more questions?
Yeah, the question you asked Sudam, that
how we
check this, the spectrum is correct. Yeah.
Spectrum, whenever you get a spectrum, actually it's always correct. There is nothing that you get a wrong spectrum. It can be a very faded spectrum that you have not shine your metal properly. So suppose when we go to this synchrotron facility, we really need to fix our metal at a particular position, and we need to shine X-ray on the metal particularly. So there is a procedure of preparing the material for excess. So if you don't prepare the material well, that can be a problem. Then you get crappy spectrum. Otherwise, spectrum is never wrong. So it's not like XRD that you have to match the peaks and phases. It's not like XRD. So there is not a wrong spectrum. Even XRDs are not wrong. You just get to see that whether you have prepared the right material or not. So here also nothing, there is no database. You just look at the spectrum, look at the previous reported data that you have, whether your spectrum looks similar or not. If it's not similar, what is wrong? Like what is different? You know, nothing wrong, nothing is wrong. What is the difference? Here you see, they both look in the spectrum, they both look very similar, but there is an energy shift. So why have I done this energy shift? Why did I get this energy shift? Why this kind of free edge I have got? So why is it different? As I couldn't answer this question, why it is having so many jumps here? Why am I seeing that? So we have to answer, we have to look at the spectra really carefully, and we need to see that what is the difference? There is nothing wrong in any of the spectra. Either you have not prepared the desired material you want, or whatever material you have prepared, there is something here and there. So you have to just figure out what is that here and there happened. That's all. There is nothing, no wrong spectrum. So there is no need to check whether the spectrum is correct or not. All spectrums are correct. You just need to see what is the difference, right? So was that helpful?
Sudam is asking.
Hmm.
Yeah, he is replying okay, and he is asking one question again, that can the oxidation state alter the lifetime of an electronic transition?
Can oxidation state alter the lifetime of an electronic transition? Lifetime means what, Sudam? Like,
I think he means that a electron is transferred upon in higher orbital, then it's coming out in lower orbital. I think he's
okay. So yeah, XAs is only concerned about that jump, just one jump. As I show in the first, okay, let me end my show and go to the first slide. here you see, if we are only in excess, we are only considering this jump. So what happens after this jump is all is not really the concern of excess. So just this jump, what amount of energy was absorbed, what is the energy difference that we saw, that's all. So if the oxidation state is different, that means I have less number of holes here. So I cannot make a lot of electrons to jump in this state. That will create a difference, but not really what happens after that. So that is not really the excess. Yeah. So that maybe you can do some XPS spectrum. That is a very good study after what happens, because it's photoelectron, photoemission. That may be the concern of XPS, but not excess. Yeah. Excess is only concerned about the absorption.
He replied, okay.
Okay. Yeah, these questions are really good. You're thinking about it. I'm really thankful to all of you guys. Yeah, that's an honor. Yeah. Any more questions? Any more questions, guys? I guess not. So let me thank you guys once again for giving me the opportunity to present the talk. I'm really happy to
be. There is also one question.
Okay, great, great. I'm really happy that I'm
it's
happy.
Explained by Sam that he asking that how to extract pair distribution function from XAS data.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Pair distribution function is not my genre. Ma'am can see I suck at it. Pair distribution function, no, Sudham. I'm really sorry. I don't know whether I'm not sure whether how to do that. Yeah, I'm sorry. Oh, thanks, Abhinav.
So listen, actually the field which Indrani presented, it is a very broad field, okay? It is not possible for anyone to know all the aspects, especially if she has joined maybe 1 year back, right? So many people in India also, many people are working with synchrotrons and all. So don't, means if she is not able to answer anything, don't feel that. And Indrani, don't feel embarrassed, okay? It's okay. I know this is a very huge, very, very huge field, okay? Many people are working on this. And various people are working on various aspects. And if you are taking everything together, then it constitutes the whole field. And yeah, maybe some physics people will be able to answer this one better than the chemistry people, okay?
Exactly. So, pair distribution is like, I know.
Exactly. I also got scared. Oh my God, what is this question? Because it is very difficult, because you need mathematician and physicists to do all this thing, okay? Okay, it was a nice presentation.
Thank you. Okay, guys, thanks then.